Heavy Metal.
Did you ever read Heavy Metal magazine?
A few issues. I did see both the movies. There was really, where I lived growing up, there was no way to get a hold of Heavy Metal. I grew up in a small-ass town, so.
They'd have known if you were getting Heavy Metal, if you even had it available. You couldn't, like, it wasn't like that discreet, semi-pornographic magazine that you could get without anybody knowing it.
No. I would have had to drive into Milwaukee or Waukesha to get it. To be honest with you, I don't even think I knew about it until the movie.
How'd you see the movie?
Like VHS, I think.
Yeah, because for a long time it wasn't available on any format except theatrical. If you could see like a print of it at a revival theater or something.
Yeah, it was definitely a bootleg. Like, I remember I had gone to, and it must have been when I was 18 or 19, because we had a comic convention in Milwaukee, which wasn't very big at the time. But I picked up like probably a dozen bootleg movies, and that was one of them. So,
what about this have
it,
been?
I liked it. It kind of had that, what's the deal? I'm trying to think of one. It had that eerie kind of vibe to it. Shit, I can't remember what I'm trying to think, but.
You talking about, when you say eerie, are you talking about like the Warren magazines and stuff, like the Apparella and the like? Or just like eerie as in just generally having a vibe to it, like that cult movie, forbidden quality?
Yeah, almost kind of like a creep show, almost, I guess. You know, they would have the if I'm remembering right, Creepshow would have like one of their movies was like three little, it was like an anthology. And I kind of got the same vibe from that. So, but that's as far as my heavy metal knowledge goes.
And when about did you see the movie though?
When? So that would have been 93, 94, somewhere around there.
And what did you think about the sequel?
I liked the sequel because there was hit, but it wasn't the same. It was a good little cartoon, but.
What about the soundtrack? Tracks.
Soundtracks were cool. Couldn't tell you now what I know it was all like hard rock stuff, but I can't recall off the top of my head. I probably at the time when I watched the second movie, I probably liked the second movie better because it was just a long action deal, and I think it was the first time I had seen tits in cartoon form, and I was like, whoa. But I think I watched them both a couple of years ago, and I like the first one a lot better now. So
I think the quality of the tits was better than the first one too.
It could have been. Was there tits? That's in the first one too?
Oh yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, then maybe it was the first one that I was just like, oh yeah. I don't know. I sound like a fucking creepo.
Oh, well, no. I mean, we're talking about heavy metal. If you don't talk about breasts, I don't think you're doing it right.
Yeah, then I thought that about the first. Then I did like the first one a lot.
Columbia Pictures takes you beyond the future to a universe you've never seen before.
I think you're going a little high, man.
It's okay, man. If there's one thing I know, it's how to drive when I'm stoned. It's like you know your perspective's fucked, so you just gotta let your hands work the controls as if you're straight.
Oh, wow. Good landing, man.
A universe of mystery.
Okay, sucker. Hand over your cash. Now.
A universe of sexual fantasies.
My whips.
Harry? Can I sleep with you?
That was incredible. I've never felt anything like it.
A universe of magic.
Yeah.
beyond science fiction.
See it theatrically, so I can't really like my first viewing of heavy metal was while I was unemployed 2 weeks ago. I can't, as far as that goes, I can't really put myself in the sneaking into the, you know, the bizarre theatrical sneak into the dollar show like Mr. Fix-It had or whatever the fuck your story was. Not that I wasn't paying attention, but
apparently you were not.
Well, you know, I just streamed it. Like, it's not, there's nothing romantic to it. So I will happily discuss the film, but any more nostalgic related anecdotes really, it's not getting it for me.
So we'll begin at the beginning of the movie. It starts with the story is Soft Landing. It's based on the comic of the same name by Dan O'Bannon and Thomas Workington. Dan O'Bannon of course is definitely part of that zeitgeist.
Return of the Living Dead,
right? This is the guy that worked with John Carpenter in the early days on his student film, created Aliens, obviously heavily influenced by guys like H.R. Giger and Moebius, and you know, a ton of these people were all gathered together by Alejandro Jodorowsky to do the failed 70s attempt at Dune. And a lot of heavy metal influence went into that project, or the fact that project existed maybe influenced heavy metal being transported over from France to the United States. So the sequence is pretty straightforward. It plays over the song Radar Rider by Riggs. And you want to explain it, fix it?
Basically, it's just an astronaut in a, what is that, Firebird?
Corvette.
A Corvette. And he's being launched out of a fucking space shuttle to land on Earth, which, and it's rotoscope, right?
Oh yeah.
And so yeah, just, you know, fucking cool beginning. And as the car is entering the atmosphere, it pulls out a parachute, it lands, he drives up to a farmhouse, his farmhouse, he arrives, his daughter screams, "What did you bring me?" He laughs, takes off, you know, walks in and introduces us to the Lochnar.
Well, to introduce the listeners to the Lochnar.
It's a glowing green ball, right? Lochnar, and which is the comp. So heavy metal, this animated film, is a series of short stories, but Lochnar is sort of the
glue
link
that holds it all together.
Yeah, it's the link between all of them. It's the commonality through all these stories. The stories go all through time and scenarios and whatnot, but they all sort of, you know, kind of surround Lochnar, the glowing green ball from space.
When Dark Star was released in the early to mid-70s, the John Carpenter, Dan O'Bannon project, the movie poster was an image from toward the end of the picture featuring astronauts surfing through space. In this case, he was surfing on debris. And very much captures the feel of the times and that feel of heavy metal. And I always kind of figured that this story was maybe riffing off of that, since it's also Dan O'Bannon. There's something in some of the movie posters for heavy metal also features the Corvette being dropped in the lower, in the upper atmosphere, and slowly creeping down to Earth. Very excellent introduction credit sequence for something like this. Very reflective of the aesthetic. And badass song. I like Radar Rider. In particular, I got a car a while back, and it was the first time I had a car that was radar ready. That actually helped, you know, they would detect vehicles around you and shit. Usually I got decade-old beaters, and I finally got an actual new car. And because of that, Radar Ready would appear whenever I turn on the car. I was constantly thinking, Radar, Rider, whenever I would drive that vehicle. So, what do you guys think of the song?
Dude, the whole soundtrack's nice. Now, I'm curious what Matt thinks, because this is early metal.
It's all, like, yacht rock shit. Okay, it's all yacht rock. But I don't say metal. Shit, is it better? No, it's not metal, it's yacht rock. It's... look, I was surprised there's a lot of names in the soundtrack that were that I knew, but let me see. I might have made a note on a couple tracks I actually recognized. But outside of, you know, Heavy Metal by Sammy Hagar, because you used it in a one song each, I don't think any of them really jumped out. Could I be wrong? I could be wrong. I got to re-read through these notes. It's been a couple weeks.
Wrong.
All right.
We're going to go through the songs and we're going to talk about the movie, so you'll have opportunity. You have this magazine in France called Metal or Lawn. Starts in 1974, translates into Howling Metal, does well enough that they carry it over to the United States in 1977, redub it Heavy Metal, and that's when the magazine gets started. Now, Mr. Fix-It, you didn't read the magazine first. I know you have an origin story with relation to heavy metal, so I know you've kind of already told it, but if you want to tell like a short version of it again, we can hear that.
Went to a local comic shop. I'm digging through bins, find this magazine-sized comic. Looks pretty cool. Start flipping through it. Oh, look, there's boobies. And at the time, I am a youngster, so I'm shocked that no one is telling me anything. I take it to, and actually, this was a guy that used to go to your shop. He had his own shop. Yeah, he ran his shop out of his house or some shit.
Well, like no, that. Before that, he ran the satellite of Third Planet that they had in Pasadena, back over near the drive-thru liquor store.
So I think it was there I bought it. I want to say it was definitely with him. But find us this adult comic book, and it was definitely an eye-opener. And so, I bought one copy. I think he only had one copy at the time, so, flipped through it. There's a lot of nudity, a lot of violence. I hadn't seen that yet in comics because I'm still, just a Marvel fanboy. And then I think I went to a Walgreens and I found one there. Like, they had it on the magazine rack, and I remember thinking, holy shit, like, it's here. And so I was allowed to purchase it, which I was shocked. And I started kind of following it. You would find them at different comic shops in the long boxes. And that was pretty much it, man. That was my exposure to the comic first before the movie came out.
So I thought that you'd seen the movie 40 years ago when it first came out. Did you?
No, I did. We did in the theaters, but I was exposed to the comic first, or the book, because I remember seeing that first.
Really? Okay, because we're talking like 81, dude. You saw the magazine before you saw the movie?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. The Third Planet guy, was that place was open that far back?
Well, no. He had the other shop. It was another shop. It was like a house.
Okay, so he had a house, because this I wasn't aware of, is the guy you're talking about, I know that he ran a Third Planet satellite store, because that was pretty much the first...
In South Houston.
Right. That was pretty much the first proper standalone comic shop I ever saw. And it was funny, because I lived in that neighborhood for like a year or so, and I found that shop like within a few weeks of us moving. So I only got to enjoy it for a very small amount of time, and we moved out of state too. That's when we moved to Nevada. So it was very frustrating to have a comic shop for such a brief blip of time. And then years later, when I'm running comic shops, I become aware that this guy had run a shop out of his house, and he'd more or less shut it down because I think he wasn't getting his bills paid to Diamond. And so he kept his back stock though. And so I would go to his house, I'd call him up, or back when you had to call people, they didn't have text back then. I'd call him up and I'd make arrangements to go into his attic, or not his attic, his garage. And I'd spend hours digging through his boxes that were just piled up in his garage, choking on the cat hair that was every fucking where. you remember that shit. And what was cool is the dude was like such a, I think he had done construction. And so he made good money, and then he pumped a ton of money into his comic collection and other like fan stuff, but mostly the comics and magazines. And he had really eclectic taste. He'd open the shop, he'd close the shop, but the shop was mostly based on the stuff that he bought that he liked anyway. And so you could definitely find like really cool shit like heavy metal, because he was into cool stuff. He was just that kind of guy. And then eventually I think he finally like sold off the stuff, or I don't know what ended up happening to the guy, because I think we lost contact with him before I closed my last shop. But he was really good for that kind of stuff. But I did not realize that he had started out having a garage thing, then did the Third Planet thing, and then went back to the garage. That's a kind of a shit trajectory.
I want to say that's because I remember he was even renting. I don't know. It was in his garage. I remember it was in his garage, like all the book. Like he would just open. You would go through the side. He had all the books in the garage, and then his house shop. But I don't think he had a name or anything for the shop yet. Only reason I knew about it was because I knew friends that were going there, and they would say, "Hey, let's go to the shop." Because I, at that time, I think we would go to Third Planet every once in a while, but you had to find a family member to drive you out there, which was kind of hard to do sometimes. But I want to say my exposure, I was exposed to the comic first. Now my dad took us to go see the movie, and I always remember we saw it because we did a double feature that night where my father took us to go see Back to the Future in the early evening, and then that night we went and saw Heavy Metal at like a fucking midnight showing in this fucking mall theater that was out in the middle of nowhere. I remember that because me and my sister, I think I've already told that story where there's all these dudes in black t-shirts and blue jeans, and I'm just like, where the fuck are we? Like, what is going on? And my dad's there with his girlfriend, and me and my sister are sitting there, and my dad sits me and my sister in front of him. She falls asleep pretty immediately, and the fucking intro starts up, and I'm like, okay, this is kind of cool. But I didn't correlate the movie and the comics together, because dude, the comics were out, the book was out longer than that, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean the magazine was out in the United States in 77. The cartoon came out in 81. Fair few years ahead of time. And plus, if you're in comic shops, if you're checking out the newsstand, the opportunity to find heavy metal was more readily available. Whereas catching a movie, it was kind of up to your parents whether or not you get to go to that. And of course, we've joked about how inappropriate it was for your dad to take you to that fucking movie.
Yeah.
So most of us us wouldn't have gotten the chance to even go to the movie if we'd wanted to in that time period, because our parents would have known better than to take us to that shit.
Well, my dad has a unique parenting philosophy when it comes to that shit. So we were definitely raised a little different than most kids. I mean, I don't know many parents who would drop off their youngsters at a fucking, back then it was what, Super Track, and just stuff a 20 in your pocket and be like, I'll be back in 2 hours. And then you just kind of fend for yourself at an arcade for 2 hours.
I mean, so. I think that's how all of us were raised. My mom did the same thing.
Really?
Yeah, she would just drop us off in an arcade and give us home, or a mall or whatever. And that's what it was, bro.
Yeah, well, no, the mall thing was normal, but the mall, you were kind of safe. Dude, we're going to a fucking video game arcade place at like midnight, or not that late, maybe kind of like 8-ish, 9-ish. And I just always thought it was kind of crazy because we'd be dropped off and like, it's just me and my step siblings and my sister kind of fending for ourselves and just, you know, trying to be careful. And I mean, I never felt like in danger. Nowadays, dude, what, I would never do that with my kids in a million years. Like, I don't know about y'all. I think that's fucking insane.
Dude, we used to, like, I was at a buddy's house. This is when we lived in Northern Arizona. And we needed something from his dad. And his dad owned, like, a real estate agency across town. So he didn't answer his phone. So we just got on our bikes and rode there. Dude, I've, like, kind of tried to map it from memory. And it was, like, 25 miles through, like, the mountains of Northern Arizona on our bikes. And we went there. And I think we even showed up. And he was like, what the fuck are you doing here? Like, how did you get here? Did someone drop you off? We're like, no, we just rode our bikes all the way across town, busy highway. Like, we're like on the shoulder of highways and stuff, just riding around. Just, it's bizarre to think. And now it's like, if your kids ride more than, you know, 1,000 feet to a school on their bikes, it's like, you're a horrible parent. It's so bizarre.
True.
Yeah, I think there was elements of that in amongst baby boomers, but definitely Generation X, the feral nature of our upbringing. We were called the latchkey generation for a reason. We just had like bizarre levels, what today would be considered bizarre levels of freedom. The first segment within the movie is Harry Canyon. It's been said that this story influenced books, I mean, movies like The Abyss, Blade Runner, Star Wars, Alien, Tron, and The Fifth Element. It's based on the original story by Daniel Goldberg and Lynn Blum, based on The Long Tomorrow by Moebius. And I think it was actually Moebius with Dan O'Bannon. So again, O'Bannon had a pretty heavy influence.
Are you trying to say Morbius?
Huh? I say Moebius. Whatever, the artist, the French artist, the guy who designed like the space suits for Alien and was one of the more prominent creators among the French, but also among European sci-fi and fantasy. And this is basically your typical boilerplate, you know, private dick kind of story, except that the detective isn't actually a detective. It's a taxi driver. Very much shades of The Fifth Element there. And he picks up a hot girl who's being chased by mobsters, and they're all after the Loch Nahr, essentially. And so, you know, there's dirty dealings and people get melted into puddles of goo, and just that whole aesthetic, that whole, you know, sci-fi mixed with old pulps, where you're not, you know, nobody's basing any new technologies on anything we're seeing in this segment, but it definitely has that vibe that you'd expect from something like cyberpunk. And I've looked at the original The Long Tomorrow, and it's a very, very, very loose adaptation. For starters, everybody in the Moebius story, it looks like somebody from a Moebius story, so they've got the weird, like, safari hats and long coats and all this kind of goofy shit. But, you know, it has an interesting, like, the art style used is very interesting because it looks very much like somebody drawing with a ballpoint pen. It doesn't look like any kind of animation before or really since, because it has that crude alt quality to it. And given that this is based on a Moebius story, it looks nothing like Moebius as far as the presentation. It's very American and very grungy.
It is Moebius, but just so we know, it's Moebius.
I was going to say Moebius, but...
M-O-E, like Mo, like Larry Moe and Curly. Although, I don't know. Is that M-O-E? I don't know. It's Moebius. But, as soon as you said... I already had Fifth Element written in my notes. I'm like, dude, it's total Fifth Element vibe. From in the very beginning, he's like a taxi driver. He comes across this woman. Like, that's the whole... That is the Fifth Element. Like, bare bones. From the very beginning. Now, obviously, the women turn out to be different. But I loved how at the very end, because she basically doubled. Are we going to want to like talk the actual story of these things or not?
As much as you guys feel like you need to.
Okay, so basically, what do you call it? This woman's husband had Loch Nahr.
I think it was her dad.
Her dad found it, yes, because they're out there digging, because that's a psychic war by
Blue Oyster Cult.
Cool metal song. Was that Frank?
Yeah, the Veteran of the Psychic Wars by Blue Oyster Cult. The Blue Oyster. Don't Feel the Reaper
metal.
Guys.
But the father.
It reminds me, too. It sends me back because because in my message board days back in the late 90s, I knew a guy who listed his occupation as veteran of the psychic wars. So that always reminds me of that cool song too. Nice
very
little like
metal.
Dirge thing.
Very metal. But that the father finds it. The assistant who was picking it up melts away. So they're like, oh shit. The next scene we have the father being shot, falls through the door. The daughter's running away, being chased by the gangsters. She hops into Harry's cab. Harry starts driving. Next is, I'm trying to remember the name of the song. Was it
True
Hagen?
Companion by Donald Fagen?
No.
Because that one I don't remember as well. Or are you talking about Blue Lamp by Stevie Nicks?
No, that's later. I can't remember the name of the song. But the song's playing. He's being followed by two of these guys in hover bike. He shoots one off. He kills one with this cool gun that pops out of his back tail light. The other one smashes into an overhead bridge. They go and hide. Or he decides to see where she wants to be taken. Looks in the back. She's passed out. Takes her to the police station and walks into the police station. The wonderful, truly missed John Candy is voicing the cop behind the counter. There's some prostitutes sitting there telling Harry they'll kiss his ass for $5. And of course, you have the little green alien being dragged out saying that he's an American citizen. He just forgot his documents. And of course, Harry's like, you know, goddamn illegal aliens. And let's see. The cop says that you actually have to pay for the police to do an investigation. Harry's like, here's $5, flips him a coin, calls him a punk. Harry decides to take her home. You know, he's trying to be nice, tells her she can sleep on the couch. He'll sleep on the bed. He's making himself a sandwich with a lot of mayonnaise for some reason and gets into bed. And that's whenever that was the first time I ever saw the Raiders emblem used in a bush as she's coming to the bed to seduce Harry. Am I going to do the whole episode?
Huh? The Raiders emblem? She had the Raiders emblem?
Dude, that's the Raiders emblem in her bush.
Oh, I guess I totally missed. Maybe I was typing a note when that happened.
Oh, no, dude. I saw that. I was like, dude, she has like a massive bush. Like, wow, that's a lot of bush. She, you know, he gives her the stars and stripes forever, as he likes to say, and as he's going at it. Let's see, what else?
Now, if I remember correctly, when they're going at it, that's when they play Open Arms by Journey, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and that's one of those, like, Blue Lamp by Stevie Nicks, I think is a nice enough song, and I'm not a big enough Stevie Nicks guy to would have heard it anyplace else. I mean, I like Fleetwood Mac, and I like Nicks, but with Nicks' solo stuff, especially, I'm more of a singles guy. And I like the song fine, although it's a really weird, you know, element in this soundtrack. It feels like it doesn't necessarily fit. And given that not all the songs in the movie make it onto the official release soundtrack, it's weird that was one of the ones that they actually did make it onto there. But something about Open Arms by Journey, you don't get much less metal than Journey, you know? Like, it's almost
okay,
like...
Okay, Journey is not metal. I'll give you that. Yeah.
And again, Open Arms is a really lovely love metal song, and they're fucking. So it's like, I don't know if that's... Like, I really wish there'd been something a little dirtier playing over that, because they make it seem like this is the love of a lifetime, and it's like, no, they're fucking, and that's all they're doing is fucking.
Well, anyway, so she decides that... Okay, so after they seduce... Hold on. I actually have the movie playing in the background now. That is definitely the Raiders logo in a tan color.
Take a picture and text it to me.
So yeah, that, you know, and I remember sitting in the theater as a child watching this going, holy shit, there's a theater full of dudes, man. Sausage Fest 100%. It was definitely an odd moment.
Were there any girls at the showing? Seriously?
I think there was. No, I think there was some girls, like, you know, but your typical metal chick.
Now, again, I know you were a young child, but let's do a little gatekeeping. Were there girls or were there girlfriends?
I just remember a lot of black shirts and a lot of blue jeans. Now, a lot of long hair. So, you know, it's a 50-50 shot there, man. From behind, it's a 50-50 shot.
Yeah, right. Like, you couldn't necessarily tell for sure if they were girls, much less girlfriends.
All body types were represented at this show. So if you were to have them all face forward and look at it from behind, I don't know, man. You could go 50-50, man, women. I don't know. I mean, the ratio of male to female would be really odd to pull off. I'm not lying, dude. It was like literally all black shirt, all blue jeans. Everyone had long hair. It was, you know, it's like going to a Megadeth concert.
Shots fired.
Okay. So what basically she's wanting Harry Canyon, right? To protect her. And don't they, like, these mobster dudes that want Lochnar, like, they're going to arrange, like, because they're trying to kill her. And they're like, if you just get his Lochnar, they're going to leave her alone.
Yeah. Well, because what it is it's worship in all over the universe. And so these mobsters have some buyers who want it, and they just want it back from her. So she decides to sell it to them, and she'll split it with Harry. And she's like, oh, you know, she starts playing up that she's madly in love with Harry. So Harry's like, sure, why not? So they go. And I mean, it's a legitimate drop off. She drops it off. They give her a case full of cash. She walks off. She gets back in the cab. Harry's excited, talking about how they're going to travel and do this and that. And she decides, nah, she's going to double cross him. Oh, and I forgot to mention that Harry has this little device where he has a button by the gas pedal where he flips up and he steps on it and a disintegrator ray hits the back seat and he ends up disintegrating her.
Because she double crosses him, right?
She double crosses him.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry, I had to do this. And she pulls a gun on him or whatever. So yeah. He fucking nukes her. And then don't the mobster dudes, they have Lochnar and they like touch it.
He opens it to like look at the Lochnar and be like, you know, he owns it. And it disintegrates him like anybody else. And then it starts to float off. And then it goes back. So where we left off was wherever they do the soft landing, the Lochnar is talking to a little girl, telling her the stories of basically, I mean, his greatness, like how he's worshipped around the universe, how, and it's you know, like Frank was saying, it's an anthology, but it's a way to tell the stories where he's telling her stories, which I thought was always weird. He's telling us, and he's the globe or the orb is getting larger as he's telling these stories, and the girl is freaking out because it's her father's already been killed.
Well, I think so what it was, I don't think that they trusted American audiences to allow this to be a true anthology without any connective tissue, that they had to have like an overarching narrative to drive them. Because it's very rare to see any American movies that don't have a framing sequence for something like this. And so everything has to be forced because it doesn't really make sense. Most of these stories were written to be taken in isolation. They weren't supposed to connect to anything else besides, you know, they were just a story. So trying to work the Lochnar in there some way, somehow, it's not going to necessarily pass a strong logic test, but it gets the job done. It's a green orb. It's evil. It's telling stories of how it does all this evil shit, stirring up this little girl, you know, because it's a misogynist. I don't know what the fuck, but that's the framing sequence, you know. You forgive it because you know it's just there to as guardrails for the noobs. I certainly remember roaming around the mall without a parent for hours on end. We would go to the bowling alley and my stepfather would be bowling. My mother would, I guess, be watching him or bullshitting with the lady who worked at the counter of the little dining area they had. And I'd be roaming around or I'd find some other kid and we'd cross the street in the, you know, 9, 10, 11 o'clock at night on a weekend and go to like the Walgreens across the store street or whatever, or just wander around the neighborhood in the dark, you know, shit. We all did that kind of fucking shit. You know, it was just part of our generation. And I think that heavy metal kind of reflects that because, you know, literally this was a approved porn. Like,
yes.
I mean, my first exposure was off the newsstand. You know, you go to a convenience store or something, and of course you would have actual pornography behind the counter. But back in the 80s especially, you'd have heavy metal next to, you know, your Savage Sword of Conan, you know, the Marvel black and white magazines and shit.
Exactly where I saw it, yeah.
Yeah, and it's in full color. You crack it open. It doesn't take long before you start seeing some tits. There was always going to be some tits in every issue at least, but oftentimes they'd go full on Skinamax soft core. You wouldn't see any cocks for the most part.
Yeah, some of the stories you would, dude.
Some of the stories you would. You wouldn't see graphic penetration though, definitely.
No, but they definitely described.
Sure. Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and, I was like, holy shit.
It was in this weird place, this gray area where because the material was intended for older audiences and because there was a novelistic quality to it, that there was an allowance for a greater degree of explicit nature. Plus, it pulled the same thing that Mad Magazine had done years earlier, where they weren't restricted by the Comic Code Authority or any other governing body because they were a magazine, not a comic book. And so they were in that gray area where you get away with that shit. And if you remember on the newsstand, it wasn't the only one. If you got Savage Sword of Conan, there were tits in those as well, even though they're Marvel books, you could still see tits. Or you'd get like cartoons or the Lowrider magazines, and they usually had some nudity in it as well. So it was an interesting little thing where it was almost like, before the internet, before people were exposed to shit that was warping their fucking minds, that was like a degree of maturity. It's like when you get old enough to find the heavy metal and get home with it, then you were age appropriate to be buying it, essentially. It was a tacit approval that, okay, you're old enough to, if you can afford, I think it was like $4 or $5 at a time where most comics were like 75 cents to $1.25. If you could afford it and get it home without anybody harassing you, then you'd earned it and you were mature enough to have it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. yeah. So, like, I never ever saw, I don't think I ever flipped through a heavy metal magazine.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it was ever really, if we were trying to sneak a peek at some, like, faux porn, we were just going for, like, real porn. So, I don't know, it was like, I kind of kept my porn and my comic book separate, if that makes any sense. I don't want to mingle these two things. Yeah. So, yeah, I never, like, I would always see them back behind the counter, right, where you're not supposed to, you know, because you could always see the heavy metal logo that looked cool. It was all chrome and polished, right? But, you know, it was always next to more appealing magazines for a budding young adolescent such as myself. So, yeah, I never went to enough comic book shops that, like, I never lucked into a heavy metal just out on a rack where I could pick it and flip through it. So I think by the time I really got my hands on a heavy metal magazine, it was sort of like, oh, this is some, you know, oh, this is like some overly painted power metal fantasy stories with some boobs in it, and it wasn't that big a deal to me. But I could see how if I had been maybe 10 years younger and I'd stumbled across one, it'd be pretty crazy. But by the time I actually got my hands on heavy metal, I already kind of knew what it was all about, so it wasn't that big of a deal.
Yeah, that makes sense, because there's still a little bit of an age difference between a Fix-It and me and you, because when we would get a hold of heavy metal, there was no behind the counter. It was on the rack next to all the other magazines. And that was before they had poly bags, so anybody could walk up, pick up the heavy metal, and start tossing through it. And part of, I think, the reason why I got away with it for as long as it did is the only people who would have wanted to look through an issue of heavy metal were the ones who weren't going to rat anybody out about it existing. You know, it's like we were, if you wanted something like heavy metal, you were already in the club and you knew that you needed to keep this your own special secret because you didn't want anybody else to know that you were getting a hold of that particular magazine, because you knew it was illicit. You knew that you weren't supposed to have it, and if people knew the secrets of it, then they would take it away from you. And if ultimately they did, because at some point somebody decided to start polybagging it or putting it behind the counter, and that's what you were talking about. By the time it got to you, you didn't have that access anymore.
Yeah, and like, again, if it's in the general population of magazines, it's probably a big deal. Once you're back behind the counter, it is a lot of competition for you, heavy metal. Sorry, at least from a nudity standpoint. Yeah, sorry.
A thing, too, you mentioned the comic shops, and heavy metal is a really bizarre magazine because it launches in the 70s at a time when mainstream comic fans are really abandoning the anthology, because there was a time where anthology was king. Like, all comic books were anthologies in the early days, in the 30s and stuff, because you wanted to make sure you got as broad an audience as possible. So you'd have, you know, an adventure strip next to a comedy strip next to a funny animal one. You know, they was all mixed together. Here's a grab bag, right? And then as the comic books got slimmer and slimmer because they didn't want to raise the price, the subject matter got more and more specific, and you basically had genres, and some genres sold better than others, and some were geared toward older audiences. You look at the 50s, you've got the crime books, you've got the horror books, and the little kids really weren't supposed to get their hands on them. And if they did, then it was sort of the 50s equivalent of the heavy metal, where the kid was getting something they knew they weren't supposed to get. And then, of course, you had the delinquency hearings, and all comic books got banned because of that, or the majority of them, and you had to have the Comics Code sealed to get distributed at all, and so everything got super squeaky clean and wholesome. But you still had anthologies, you still had like the soft thriller stuff, your, you know, House of Mystery and Tales of Suspense and House of Secrets, you know, that kind of stuff, where it was a very pussified version of the type of stuff that EC used to do. And I think because they were so weak sauce, and because you had the increasing dominance of superheroes, because all the other genres were on television and movies, if you wanted a Western, you could just watch a fucking Western. Why would you deal with a Western comic book? And so when it became apparent that superheroes were the only things that comic books were able to do better than they could in any other outside medium, they really came to dominate. And I think a combination of the weakness of the anthology stories, the ascendance of superhero ongoing soap opera narratives, and just the simple fact that fewer and fewer casual readers were reading comic books when they would just as soon watch television instead, there just wasn't that much of a demand for it. And then at the same time, in the 1970s, not only do you get an anthology magazine out, but it's mostly made up of international material. It's mostly repackaging shit from Europe, you know? So it does very specific taste. But again, because you had that high fantasy, sci-fi, and the adult mature qualities to it, it attracted a mainstream audience that had mostly dropped comic books. But what's weird is it doesn't seem like mainstream superhero people ever really embraced heavy metal. You almost never saw heavy metal in the comic shops. I always saw it on the newsstand. I really feel like that was a different audience, that there were it was just outside of the norm of superhero type shit, comic shop type people. And I think that because of the general bias against the anthologies that comic book fans had, there's this real prejudice against heavy metal. And it just doesn't, it's never in my experience had a strong presence in and comic shops to this day. Really, if you're going to get an issue of heavy metal, you're probably going to go to a bookseller like a Barnes and Noble. And I know those are somewhat of an endangered animal as well, but certainly I see a lot more heavy metal in the bookstores to this day than I ever have in a comic shop.
Yeah, and you know what? I think my experience with heavy metals was a gas station. I feel like I would see it, you know, in the with the blackout baggings and gas station stuff, or back behind the counter of a gas station. No? Or maybe. Maybe? Remember you used to be able to get magazines at gas stations? Remember that was like a place you would go to get your nudie mags?
I don't remember the blackout bags on heavy metal, although they definitely had suggestive covers, but I think they just had clear poly bags because heavy metal really lived and died on that logo and on the quality of the covers.
Well, I mean, no, maybe I'm thinking of the, you know, how the racks they would be on would be like high rise to cover most of the cover except for the title, and you could just stick all the magazines in there. So you could only kind of read the title. You wouldn't really be able to see what the cover was. You
know? Right. Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about. So you're at the convenience stores, the gas stations, where you'd have the lower sections that were more kid-friendly, and the upper sections tend to have a higher, like, wooden barrier. And so you just see the logos, and you have to you'd be highly visible, and you'd have to reach up to get that magazine and pull it out, and people could see you. You couldn't sneak it like we could sneak it off of the regular shelf.
Exactly.
It's not like it was ever racked next to the comic books, but it definitely wasn't racked in a high visibility section because there was a high priority magazine. And that's, again, part of, I think, what heavy metal lived for is, you know, being sneaky about some of the shit they were pulling.
So the next story we're introduced to is Den. You want to tell us a little bit about it, Frank?
Well, I'm curious, by the way, the last song on the Harry Canyon, which, by the way, I wonder if it's sort of like a Rusty Sanchez kind of thing, Harry Canyon. The last song is Heartbeat by Riggs, which definitely falls into the yacht rock category. It's kind of a forgettable one. Den is based on the character, the same name, created by Richard Corbin. How much experience have either of you guys had with Corbin?
I met Heavy Metal Magazine. There was a lot of shit in there.
Probably nothing for me. Sorry.
Would you recognize him if you saw his work?
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah.
It's very distinctive.
Very, very distinctive. Yeah, because he dates back to like the fanzines of the 1970s. And he was a guy who, I mean, he definitely did painted work, but his work almost looked like CGI before CGI. He had this weird way of doing fleshes where they had sort of a plastic quality to it, but they still kind of seemed meaty. And, you know, he was always drawing naked people. And Dan infamously was running around with his dick swinging around all the time. Den is like
Marvel work.
Huh?
He did do some Marvel work. He did the Hulk.
Sure.
He did the last story, the last Punisher story.
Well, especially later in his career in the early 2000s, Marvel had their mature readers imprint called Max, and they took advantage of that. They had him do a really pretty racist Cage miniseries with Brian Azzarello.
Oh, yeah.
And as you said, he did some Hulk stuff, and he did a fair amount of stuff. Because I think what it was is I figure Quesada and Palmiotti, when they were still working together, I think they had sort of a heavy metal mentality, and they brought a lot of that stuff to the Marvel Knights work. And so you had guys like Milo Manada and Corbin getting work at Marvel for the first time in their careers to a large degree. You know, Corbin was always, I think, too provocative for Marvel before then. But I guess in his career, he had that sort of respectability. Huh? Was it?
Did he ever do any DC work?
Not much DC work either. He was really more like Warren and heavy metal. And
okay. Because I would love to see him as like Martian Manhunter or something like that.
He would have been interesting on his character like Martian Manhunter. That would have been a good fit. Except that I think what I've seen more of the Manhunter than I'd wanted to see. But why don't you tell us
about
the story?
Oh, shit. He did a Meatloaf's Bad Out of Hell cover.
Did he? That wouldn't surprise me.
The fucking motorcycle flying off into space or whatever?
Yeah.
I mean, I can vaguely picture it. It sounds about right. Both versions too, right? Because they had a similar artwork in the Bad Out of Hell 2 from the 90s.
Did they?
I think the artwork was fairly similar. Yeah. Or I think it was subtitled Back Into Hell. And I think he's like riding, like a guy riding a bat into like a hellscape, you know?
You know what? I don't remember Bad Out of Hell 2. I only remember Bad Out of Hell 1, and that's the Corbin. I don't know if he did the second one. Maybe he did. Sure, I don't know.
So what's the story of Den?
Little nerdy kid finds a meteorite in his yard, forgets about it, starts doing some experiments with electricity, activates a Lochnar. Lochnar teleports him to another world where he went from this skinny little nerdy guy to this big ball. Let's say The Rock. Just say he looked like The Rock. Den looks
that
like
would
The
be
Rock.
Really good casting if that would ever
absolutely
come out. Yeah.
Except that means The Rock would have to walk out on screen with his Vic swinging around. That's the only thing. Because that seems to be a running theme a little bit here. And he meets some British chick, saves her from this sacrifice, gets some action. He gets captured by these mutants, taken to a priestess who was committed. They take him to the guy who's against the priestess. It's just a planet of mutants and these two humans. I'm guessing humans are teleported to this planet from Earth, and the Lochnar gives them somewhat powers, depending on how they are. Or just the men, because I believe the women just have big boobs and that's it. The men, Jen looks like The Rock, and the little guy looks like a David Spade or Andy Dick type character. More like Andy Dick.
Yeah, well, and definitely of ambiguous sexuality as well.
Yeah, so very Andy Dick. And so Jen has to prove himself, kills some mutants. The little Andy Dick guy decides to tell him, you know, I need you to get me the Lochnar, because they're obsessed with this Lochnar, because it's, you know, some kind of...
Well, I think that there, you've got two priests of different, of like cults that are against one another, and whoever gets the Lochnar is going to be the one who can open up the dimensions and control, like, the Lovecraftian creature that's eating the sacrifices and shit. So it's basically a power struggle based around the Lochnar and cults seeking it.
Yeah, but like, the little guy is immortal. Dan has been turned into the Rock, so they have powers. I don't know if the women got any powers.
Well, I think that no, the woman that Dan hooks up with is just like Dan. She's from our world, and she was not unlike the Den from our world, not a desirable example of humanity.
Okay.
Who then goes to the fantasy world and becomes a very desirable example of humanity, which is why they bone, because you have to. It's just the law. But she's totally getting off on the same way he is, because they're these, you know, Adonises and, you know, super babes and shit.
Yeah. And so the little Andy Dick guy tells The Rock that he needs to go get the Lochnar from the female priestess, and he sends him with Noro, one of his mutant men, and so they decide to go. And the artwork is absolutely stunning. It is a heavy metal comic book come to life.
Do you want to hear my note about the animation of this one? It says, the animation is as if every 80s and 90s indie comic came to life.
Yep, I agree with that. It's beautiful.
I would argue this probably
is
the best animation of the movie. Like,
no!
You don't think so?
No way!
Okay.
No, man. So beautiful, so dangerous is the most, I think, the nicest art style. This is very distinctive. I love the color palette. Like, the earth tones are not just brown and, like, a brown and brown. It's brown, red, blues, green. It looks like one of his art pages. Like, one of his art pages.
Yeah, that's one of the things that bugs me is I really wish in the sequel to, you know, not to jump ahead, but I wish in the sequel they had a sequence where they did this in CGI, because Corbin, you could absolutely do Corbin style in computer animation and capture that essential quality to it. And usually when they try to do that stuff, it's terrible, and we all just ache for seeing what should be 2D animation done in CGI. But Corbin, it's the exact opposite. I ache to see that in CGI, and they've talked a bit about doing another heavy metal. They're trying to get financing, I think. And if they don't have a Corbin sequence with CGI, that would be a real disappointment to me.
Actually, my understanding is Love Rocket Death on Netflix?
Yeah, yeah.
Those are the children of heavy metal.
Yeah, no, David Fincher developed that as a heavy metal continuation, and the deal fell through, so he just released it on his own.
Yeah, but they had to rename it something else. But those are of the lineage of heavy metal.
Totally. So, I was about to say, as soon as you started saying it, I was like, oh, yeah, it's whatever it is. Yeah.
Because when I watched those, I was like, oh, shit, I'm sorry, Heavy Metal 2 sucks ass. That fucking Fox shit is stupid. But when I love the first one, and when you watch that Netflix version of it, they go hand in hand. They're great together. It's just an updated continuation of the story. Just a side note, I at one time almost had a chance to buy a animated Cell, and it's the scene with Den and the mutant, and I still kicked myself in the ass for not picking it up. The guy was going to sell it to me for $100, because I do collect some of these animation Cells from there. I do have one from The Wizard, and some small, like, you know, Ewok, some bullshit ones, but, you know, the Wizard is that the one from the Wizard. That's one of my prized possessions now. I still kick myself in the ass, because the guy was like, at the time, Heavy Metal wasn't that big. It was at a con, like this little con in a fucking Hilton hotel. And the guy's like, $100. And I'm just like, nah, it's too much. Now, I kick myself in the ass every time I think about it.
I'm on a site that has animation Cells, and the cheapest one from Den that he's selling is $300.
Really? That's not bad.
Yeah, it's not bad. I mean, it's not a great sell either. The better ones are, you know, 500, 800, stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, see, this one was actually Den, like the whole Den with the mutant next to it. So I was like,
oh yeah, yeah, yeah. That'd definitely be more than $100.
Oh yeah, yeah. So I'm sorry, Frank. Go ahead.
No, actually, you were still finishing up the story.
So Den is doing the trip, or The Rock is doing the job for Andy Dick. He runs, they go to the female version of Andy Dick, the Empress, and they capture Den and his buddies. She's sees Den and immediately has to fuck him. And he's like, damn, on my planet, 18 years of nothing. And on this planet, twice in one day. So he's super proud of himself. Seduces her, bangs her. Turns out they steal the Loch Nahr. She blames Den. Decides to try to kill him. He escapes. Again, art style. Fucking, I don't see how y'all don't love this. Art style is so amazing. Den escapes. Rides it. Turns out the little Andy Dick guy was going to sacrifice Den's girlfriend anyway. So the two mutant armies come together and start battling. The Empress is there. The Andy Dick guy is there. The little guy, the little Andy Dick guy's trying to sacrifice her. They throw her into the water. Den leaps in to save her. He did that at the beginning. He saves her. The two main cult leaders start battling. Den wraps a chain around this spear. Throws the spear. It lands above them. Electricity strikes the spear, which then ignites the Loch Nahr. And we're assuming teleports those two, the cult leaders, back to Earth. She tells Den, you know, you could use the Loch Nahr to go back. He's like, fuck that. I'm hung like a monster. You know, I'm hung like a mule here. I'm not going anywhere. And you could rule these people. And he's like, fuck that. They jump on a bug and fly away.
Yeah. Did you ever read the original comic book story this was based on? Or any of the stories?
I would see some of the Den stuff. I think I own some of the Den stuff on some of the old heavy metals, which is crazy because I just went to a half-off bookstore not too long ago. And they had literally a shelf of just old heavy metal magazines. But they wanted like $8 to $10 a piece. And I'm like, fuck, I can't spend that. But I did look at some of the older ones. I just didn't have time. They must have had at least 40 or 50 of them, maybe 60 different books already bagged. And I would need to do a little research to see which older ones I need. Because I do have quite a few of them now from the old days. And I am missing some gaps in my collection that I would like to
Like I was saying too, there's such a prejudice against heavy metal magazine. You don't find them like back issues very often in comic shops, especially the older stuff.
Yeah.
They're not that easy to find on eBay.
Really?
Especially on good condition. I would say probably $8 to $10 a piece if that's what it costs to get some of the older shit. It's probably worth it because it's really hard to fill out runs. I have a real interest. I like Jim Steranko despite his politics of the day, and I really would like a copy of his adaptation of Outland, the 80s Sean Connery movie. But you can't find that fucking thing without it being expensive as all hell. But that's if you could fucking find it. You're talking about like $80, $100, and especially a lot of those earlier 70s heavy metals, they're going to run you a pretty penny when you can find them at all. They're just not easy to come by. And also, you know, I've been able to find some of this material on the internet. Like for a little while there, the Internet Archive had some copies of old heavy metals you could toss through. But like most of the scanning sites and shit, they don't have heavy metal either, especially not any kind of comprehensive selection. So a lot of times the only way you can read this shit is to get a collection or buy the original issues.
Yeah.
I just Googled Jim Steranko Outland. Holy shit, dude, it looks amazing.
Definitely one of the last great works he did. And obviously Sean Connery is a perfect subject for him.
Yeah, holy cow, this looks incredible. Anyway, I will say Den in my notes, worst animation of the whole movie.
Yeah.
Sorry. It was super bland. Although it does have one of my favorite lines of the movie when he first becomes Den and he's thinking to himself, he's like, I'm big. And he goes, no way I was going to walk around this place with my dork hanging out. And then he reaches up and he grabs a flag off the wall and he ties it around his waist. I think that's probably the first usage of dork instead of dick in pop culture. And I was pretty excited to hear that. I laughed out loud mightily at his dork hanging out.
I remember one of the Meatballs movies made a point of explaining what a dork was to one of the campers. So I'm not sure how the timeline works on that.
I laughed so hard.
Well, and it's worth noting too that this Den was voiced by John Candy, and probably the only time in his career he ever got to play that kind of heroic, you know, male of that sort. And the amiable quality that John Candy lends the character gives you definitely feel for the guy. You root for him automatically just because it's John Candy's voice coming out of this gigantic body. But of course, in the original comic books, the dork does stay out the entire time. That dick is swinging around the whole damn series. But if you go back to the original story, it's actually a lot longer and darker. There's a back and forth between the different priests that isn't in the animation. At one point, there's a guy that the ambiguously sexual dude, like, he steals his family to like coerce him into helping him, and it turns out like the family's already dead, and so he finds the bodies and he freaks, like they go from living to dead because he just like reanimated them to fuck the guy over, or just all this weird stuff going on. So they definitely lightened it up for heavy metal, and I imagine even though there's horror segments in the cartoon, overall the project is relatively light. It's violent, but thematically it, it's even when you've got like hot chicks getting melted, well, fuck her, she's a bitch who's going to screw the guy over anyway, that kind of thing. They definitely shy away from some of the darker elements that you would have in heavy metal and the more cynical quality to it, even though that's still present here.
10-4.
My history of comics on heavy metal is pretty intensive, but I mean, I did read a lot of the comics and stuff like that in the magazines, but I mean, a lot of that stuff was like later in life. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think the most real-time association I have with it was when they released the sequel with Julie Strain. That was back when I was in LA. So, like, I went to Golden Apple and got an autograph of Julie Strain, you know, when that came out. And I have the adaptation, you know, the one that Kevin Eastman, I think he did, like, the cover for. I think he did, like, the interiors for it, too, or something like that. And she signed it for me and all that kind of stuff. So, like, that I remember getting in real time. But I think most of the other stuff, like, you know, the a lot of it was me, like, just going through all these things, reading a lot of them either for the first time or picking up some threads of things. Because, like, when I did the video, it's like I remember I watched the first movie, I think, when I was like 12 or 13 or something. Like, my aunt probably shouldn't have showed it to me, but she did because she forgot, like, there were boobies in it or some shit. I don't remember, but she showed it to me. And then after that, I was like, oh boy, boobies, you know, like that was kind of my takeaway from that. And then I think when I was doing all the research for the video, like, that's when I read a lot of the Mobius stuff and the Den and that got me into, like, this weird track where I was reading, I read, like, a shit ton of Penthouse comics because they had, like, that Den, I don't know if you call it a sequel, but, like, this kind of, you know, Den's brother, like, Den or whatever the fuck it was. Like, it was really weird, but, like, there were all kinds of other stuff where it was, like, McGuire and Bart Sears and all these guys were doing, Adam Hughes were doing all those weird sort of Penthouse comics stuff. So I was kind of morbidly, mildly fascinated with all of it. So I was reading the Den stuff for research, but then that was, like, one of the few things, like, sometimes when I do research, then I get, like, sidetracked and I'm like, oh, this is interesting. And I just started reading, like, all the other stories where before you know it, I'm reading Kevin McGuire stories about, like, Elvis and you know, I think the Adam Hughes thing, he didn't do that many issues because I think eventually, like, his brother started drawing it or something. But there, you know, there were just, like, a shit ton of stories where, you know, it just devolved into, you know, Penthouse sexcapades, but with, like, I don't know, like, superheroes and different weird shit. So,
yeah, I had a similar track is, you know, I tossed through heavy metal on the stands oftentimes, but it didn't really make it home very often because I wasn't enough of a sci-fi guy. And when I would buy it and read it, I typically didn't really get into it that much. But I did pick up some of the Penthouse comics, and Fixit's got, I think, a complete set of that series. George Caragone was spending so much money on that book to get, like, just the best freaking artist to where if you can set aside that it's horn and just buy it as comic art, Murderer's Row of talent on there. Mm-hmm. You know, Dave Johnson was doing stuff in there. I think Russ Heath did some stuff in there. Kevin Nolan did a bunch of stuff. I think he was doing the Scion strip in that one. You know, just glorious. So I think Jason Pearson did some stuff in that. Mark Texera did some painted work in that one. I know that I'm sure a lot of people, they hear Penthouse and they know that there's sexual stuff in there, and so they might be averse to it. But if you're a comic art fan, it's really hard to turn that down just for the comic art alone. But me, I'm not averse to porn, so it's like, yeah, you know, double bonus, you know, good job. But that was one of the issues I had too, is heavy metal worked better for me as porn than it did as comics. And when I could get a hold of actual porn, that I had that much less interest in heavy metal. But knowing how much it, how important it is to Mr. Fixit and his development and his tastes, I've subjected myself to those two movies and done research. And as you mentioned, like with Den, they actually, I think it was Fantico of all people, did a solo Den series that ran about 8 or 9 issues. It was very bizarre and got far away from the fantasy, power fantasy shit, the barbarian shit that would made it fun in the heavy metal. It got into more like a dystopian sci-fi thing and like body swapping and shit going on. And like, you know, his relationship with the female character from the strip. And I think she's supposed to have died. Just all this really dark, bleak shit. And I don't think it, and when the series finally ends, and I think that's probably around the time the company itself was starting to fall apart as well. They even say in the letters column, well, this was an interesting experiment, but if we ever come back and do more Den, it'll probably be closer to what we were doing in Heavy Metal Magazine, which is what you guys wanted anyway. And for some reason, they also, they did that book without any nudity. And like, it's sort of a hallmark of Den to have cocks flapping around and titties bouncing around and shit. And of course, to be in full color, and this was in black and white, it just seems like this weird misadventure trying to do something using the Den branding without understanding what people were reading Den for. And I'm sure there are people who are buying it just because it's Corbin, but I do think there was a sort of a bait and switch where if you may be a Corbin fan and you may be a Den fan, but you're maybe not getting what you want from this particular title. And then as you're saying, he goes off and does the Penthouse Comics stuff. I'm sure for that money, you know, want to rake in those dollars, but it definitely feels like that's a better vehicle for Den stories than this Fanico bullshit where they try to play it serious, and that part of the fun of Den seemed to me to be that it was a bit of a goof.
That was, I mean, I think the only other thing I can point to, and it's not technically heavy metal, but I think the first time outside of seeing that heavy metal movie that I associated heavy metal with comics was when Byrne did that Critical Mass one shot for Dark Horse, and he basically referred to it as his quote-unquote heavy metal story. So in some ways I kind of feel like that was my first heavy metal comic, even though it has nothing to do with heavy metal.
Well, I think heavy metal is a state of mind regardless of who's doing the actual publication, but I don't remember Critical Mass at all. That's a complete blind spot for me. I have no recollection of that at all. When was that?
It was back when they were,
I assume, during the Next Men days, right?
Yeah, it was during the Next Men days. I feel like it was in between Next Men and Babe or around that time frame. And like, so it was just this one shot. And I mean, it's kind of hard to describe, but it was basically Byrne doing Enough Said, like where, you know, it was like the Snake Eyes silent issue. There was no dialogue. It was all art. You know, I mean, if I describe the story, it would sound kind of boring and stupid, but it's not. Like, I mean, it was just like, you know, it was like Spaceman shows up, but Spaceman is human man, takes off his spacesuit, is naked, comes across nubile young woman who's super sexy and naked, and they have sex, and everything's great. But then this gigantic alien monster craziness comes out. Spaceman, who is human man, freaks the fuck out, is probably a metaphor for, you know, I'm scared of fatherhood or whatever, runs the fuck away out of his spacesuit, never to return, and then you see at the end, like, the woman's pregnant or whatever. But and if I recall correctly, the crazy alien thing was not going to eat him. It was just like, hey, I think it was like some guardian of the woman, or you know what I mean? Like, it was all a big misunderstanding or whatever the fuck it was. But like, that was his heavy metal or whatever, you know? Like, I think in his, you know, like, they had the little letter column or whatever you want to call it, the editorial thing, and he kept describing it as his, you know, he's like, I always thought of this as my heavy metal story, but, you know, ultimately it was Dark Horse who published it because he was doing, like you said, the Next Men and the Babe and the, you know, Torch of Liberty and that kind of, you know, whatever, that legendary imprint, like, like it was right in the midst of all that stuff. And you know, of course, you know, boobies and all that stuff that always stood out to me. So
did John Byrne ever have any kids? I don't think so, right?
I mean,
I know he was Kieron Dwyer's stepdad at one point in time.
That's the only thing I'm familiar with. I don't know, man. He seems like too much of a fucking asshole to have kids, but you know,
right?
That's just me.
Well, but at least he's not enough of an asshole to have kids, though. So you gotta give him some points for that. Knowing better than to do that.
He knows better than to have kids.
Was there any music in this one? Reach Out by Cheap Trick.
Yeah.
On to the next one.
So this would be Captain Stern, based on the character of the same name created by Bernie Wrightson.
Nice.
And in my first exposure to Captain Stern, one of the early Dreadstar comics, I think it was the sixth issue, Plan M, I read it in the epic newsstand re-release called Dreadstar and Company. And because the story came up short, they ran this Bernie Wrightson Captain Stern short. And then again in the early 90s, I think it was Kitchen Sink Press did a bookshelf format miniseries collecting a lot of the old heavy metal strips. I don't think I've ever read the specific story being adapted in the cartoon, but I was definitely familiar with the character even before I ever saw heavy metal.
Why don't you tell us about this one, Matt?
Okay, basically, we're in space. We're in a space station. We're at a trial. Captain Lincoln F. Stern is on trial for all sorts of atrocities where they're like running down the counts, where it's like, you got a, 10 counts of piracy and 100 counts of rape and da 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 da. And then.
And one moving violation.
Yeah, and one moving violation. So he basically goes, not guilty. He pleads not guilty, all of them. So then they call like a witness to the stand who you assume that he's bribed, or they talk about how he's bribed. And the dude's name's Hanover Fist. And he basically gets Hanover Fist, everybody? The dudes. Yeah. And instead of getting up there and talking about how, oh no, he's innocent, he didn't do any of this stuff, he starts like saying even worse shit that he did, right? And then I guess as he's doing it, he's getting more and more worked up until he hulks out into this giant.
Forgot to mention that when Hanover is walking to the court, he finds the Loch Nahr rolling as a little marble.
Oh, is that? Yeah, that does happen, right? Yeah. Okay, I missed that part.
Because again, apparently the Loch Nahr can change sizes, or maybe each universe, the humanoids are different sizes, but it's a little marble that he bumps into and he finds it. So when he's walking to court, they call Hanover Fist. He goes up and he starts talking. He starts playing with the marble. And as he's playing with it, the Loch Nahr, I guess, starting to slowly give off its evil energy. And he starts, like you said, talking about all the other crimes. Because again, what he's being convicted of is like fraud and rape and murder, which is horrible. But then Hanover starts talking about like really fucked up shit that he's done, like even worse than that.
Yes,
because again, Captain Stern his whole defense is dependent on this one guy's testimony.
So, but as the dude hulks out, he just basically starts destroying everything in the space station going after Stern. So Stern's basically, running from him. He's, people are dying left and right. Fucking walls are getting crashed through. And then he gets to where he corners him and he's all hulked out. And Stern's like, good job, Hanover, or Mr. Fist. And then he hands him his part of the money. And when he does that, he kind of calms down, de-hulks out, turns back into Hanover Fist. And then Stern hits like a trapdoor under him and he falls out of the space station. And the Fist and the Lockstar and the Loch Nahr go plummeting towards Earth's atmosphere.
And then real quick, the prosecutor is voiced by Dean Warner from Animal House fame.
Really? It says in on Wikipedia, it says John Flannery does.
Really?
It's Charlie the lawyer. Joe Flannery.
Yeah, that would be Captain Stern's attorney, but the prosecutor.
Oh, my bad.
Yeah,
there were a lot of SCTV guys doing voices for this. So I'm wondering if there was a Canadian production or something. One thing that only just now hit me is it's easy to go to the frame of reference of him hulking out like the Incredible Hulk. But what's funny is the Captain Stern story I read was in Dreadstar number 6. In issue number 5, it tells sort of the same story where Eddie and Skivo are getting chased around a building by a guy named Two-Ton that also hulks out and wrecks this complex and ends up seeming to perish when he goes out a window and falls to his seeming death. I wonder if maybe Starlin was inspired by the original Bernie Wrightson story, and of course they were buddies. One thing I like is I'm a much bigger fan of Wrightson as a horror guy. I'm not really into him doing humor type stuff, especially since he's basically doing like Brock. What's the name of the guy from Futurama? The Captain guy?
Yes.
Yeah, that's basically who Captain Stern is. And so it's a humor story, but I think that the animation does a good job of capturing Wrightson's humor style. And while it's not my favorite medium for Wrightson's artwork, I very much prefer the horror stuff. I think they do a good job of looking like a Wrightson piece in the cartoon.
It does, but I still thought the animation was not as good as the rest of these stories, but better than Den. That's all. As far as creators go, who are some of the big creators to spot? I would assume it's a lot of British.
Inky Bilal.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, that's one of those ones that I would see advertised. I think that's one of the ones who's done a lot of stuff for Humanoids. I think that they also did a fair amount in heavy metal back in the 80s. But it never seemed like the ones that I got had Bilal artwork. So it was always like cool looking covers that were in like their back issues or their graphic novel advertisements, but not something I had firsthand experience with. Moebius.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with him.
Very familiar familiar with Mobius.
Actually, I just watched a documentary about him not too long ago.
I know I've mentioned it on the podcast before. Mobius did, of all fucking things, an Iron Man poster for fucking Marvel in either the early 90s or late 80s that is so weird and rad looking. And I think I've still got the poster somewhere in a closet somewhere.
Dude, how is that not framed?
Oh, if I find it, I'll frame it. I don't have a clue where it is. I have like a huge poster tube where I just like rolled all my posters up through time as tight as I could, one on top of the other. So I'd have to pull it out of the tube and unravel all of them to find it.
Oh, I'm in the same boat. I found my poster tube. Hey, Frank, I still have that martial law poster you gave me a long time ago.
Yeah, you mentioned that. Yeah, I would love to see that up someday.
I saw it. And I'm like, I rolled it up immediately, put it back. I'm like, that's it. I got it. When I get a little money aside, I'm framing these puppies.
Like right now on eBay, that poster's for sale for $200.
What?
The Mobius Iron Man poster. Dude, it is so weird. I don't even remember where I got it from.
Yeah, it's so funny how ripped the Iron Man is. You know, how organic he looks there.
Yeah.
Dude, Marvel Legends has to do a figure of that.
Oh, for sure. That'd be awesome.
I just remember Stan Lee was a huge fan of the artist and sought him out for that Silver Surfer graphic novel.
Yes,
and I think that went a long way toward legitimizing him with American audiences that, like, this is the one guy that Stan Lee really wants to work with late in his career.
Oh, he did a Silver Surfer one that's really cool, too.
Mm-hmm. I remember that one.
Not demanding the price that the Iron
Man. That's a $200 poster. That's crazy, dude.
I mean, it's listed for $200. I don't know if someone's buying. Listen, I guess he did like a whole series of them because there's a Daredevil one. Looks like this is a Punisher one that maybe it's like obviously Mike Zeck influenced. Like he must have just got some Zeck materials. Like, oh, cool. I'll do a poster. Anyway, I don't have a lot of Mobius experience. I know who Mobius is, but not a lot of experience other than owning a really random Iron Man poster.
Luis Royo.
So yeah, this is the shit whenever I think of heavy metal. This is the dude. This is it right here.
This is the one that I would see on the back covers where they're selling print.
Well, and also he did a lot of the front covers. Yeah, and same boat for me. For me, Luis Royo is heavy metal. All of my favorite heavy metal covers. If it wasn't him, he was among the top favorite ones for me. I just love his artwork and I so associate it with heavy metal. And again, he's the one who did the cover of my favorite issue. Aspiri? Alfonso Aspiri specifically?
Okay. I used to see this, look familiar.
I remember seeing his artwork, his graphic novels on for sale, but I don't have very much experience with his artwork.
Like fantasy elf shit. I mean, I never bought any of it, but I recognize it through flipping through stuff.
Yeah, that Lorna character was in a lot of issues of heavy metal. I like his style okay, but it's not really to my taste broadly, so not one of my favorites, but one that I would definitely see in collections, you know, so helping to be an ambassador to the brand, I would say, since there were a lot of collections by that artist. He did a lot of low-key erotica type stuff, too. Kaza?
Who?
Bless you.
No.
I feel like that moth-winged chick looks familiar. Maybe?
This does not look familiar to me at all.
Philippe Drouet.
No.
Is it Vader? This looks very Star Wars. Yeah, that's Star Wars, right?
Probably.
Death Star. Yeah. I am not familiar with this artist. Very cool looking, though.
Definitely another one of those ones that I would see in collections and stuff, but didn't really resonate with me.
Looks like a Giger take on
Star No. Wars. Do you remember one time we went to that? I don't know if you were with us, Mac. We went to this shop that sold posters, like those actual posters, the old school posters. And he had a bunch of posters from like Europe where they would do their own interpretation of the movie.
The Retro Art Gallery.
Yeah,
one of my favorite places.
Because I remember I was gonna buy that Planet of the Apes one.
I think Frank and I had many conversations. So basically, with people, if you're actually still listening to this podcast, it was a company that all they did was specialize in old movie posters from old movie posters, old propaganda posters, like tobacco and chewing gum and you know Goodyear tires or rubber, and it was from all throughout time, from all over the planet. So like you know Japanese Star Wars posters, just to keep it nice and nerdy. But they also had like Le Mans racing posters and all these crazy like Polish. Wasn't there some Polish artist?
Yeah,
I feel like all the Polish versions of movie posters were some of the craziest shit ever.
Oh yeah, they were fucking bizarre as shit. Because he'd be like, "What movie do you think this is?" And it's like this fucking dude with a shotgun in his mouth and this and that. And it's like, "Oh, this is It's a Wonderful Life." I'm like, "What?"
Yeah,
it was their interpretation of the movie. Yeah,
but they were like original. Like, and these weren't like reproductions. These were the original ones. And some of them were like 20 feet high, or maybe not that, maybe like 15 feet high. And you had to get them to come help you, like go through them and stuff. And none of us had any sort of funds to purchase any of these things. So we were basically in there just keeping them busy. And they were like, yeah, you guys aren't going to actually buy shit. And then they eventually, I think they ended up closing the place and just taking it all online. Because I felt like they sold most of their stuff online anyway, or to people overseas anyway. So they didn't really need a physical location, which sucks because I love to go there and just waste time. But
I remember one time because I wanted to buy that Planet of the Apes poster. That was so weird, the Ukrainian one. And the guy kind of talked me out of it. He's like, this is an investment. Like, this is a, like, you're just not going to put tack and put this on the wall. This is an, because it was a big poster too. It must have been at least like 5 feet tall, like long wide. And I remember thinking, it's pretty big. And I remember Pussycat was there with me. And I was like, I was really interested in it. But the guy pretty much like talked me out of it. Because it was quite expensive.
So just to give you guys an example we're talking about, just go look up the Polish version of the Alien movie poster. And this is what we're talking about, where it's just art. It has nothing to do with the actual movie. They didn't even show, they probably just gave the artist like a synopsis of what the movie's about and told them to just make a movie poster. But artistically, the poster is incredible. It looks amazing. But for you to have guessed that it's the movie poster for Alien, there's no way. You would never know. Unless you spoke Polish or something, or read Polish.
That's not Arthur Saddam.
Looks cool. Looks very heavy metal.
Charlie and Flytrap.
And of course, he does all the zombie posters now and stuff. Now, you read some of the Charlie and Flytrap stuff though, right?
Fuck yeah. I love that shit back in the day. And again, most of that you found either in Epic magazine or was it Heavy Metal? I think that was in Epic, wasn't it?
He did both, as I recall.
But I want to say I think I read most of his stuff in the Epic magazine.
Boris Vallejo?
Yeah, of course. I know Boris, but not from Heavy Metal. I know him from doing like trading cards and shit like that for Marvel.
Surely Fix has got something to say about Boris.
Boris, I mean, I always saw his post. I don't think I've ever... Actually, I think I do own one of his art books, though.
Yeah, you gave me one of his art books. You gave me one of his art books.
Oh, did I? I think I have another one. I think at one time I was buying those books.
I always prefer, obviously, I think Frank Frazetta is like the godfather of painted fantasy shit. Absolutely. Boris is good. I always preferred him to like Julie Bell. Who are the like brothers or something?
I know. Julie Bell is his wife. She's from Beaumont, by the way.
Yep.
Not unlike Janis Joplin, also from Beaumont.
Really? Julie Bell's from Beaumont?
Yeah, right? Weird, right?
That's random. Yeah, but what were the Hildebrand? The Hildebrand brothers.
They did a fair amount of heavy metal covers as well. But later in the 90s, I think, though.
They're last place for me of all these mainstream painted fantasy artists.
Yeah, I never liked all those autumnal colors and way too much in the fantasy, you know, bullshit, dwarves and all that kind of stuff.
I thought it got like rubbery, too.
Yeah.
Or kind of like slightly glossy or sweaty or something.
Yeah. I love Boris and Julie. Obviously the emphasis is going to be on Boris because he did so many fantastic covers in the 70s and 80s, like paperback novel covers. One of my favorite books growing up was The Girl Who Owned a City. He did the cover for that. He did a lot of movie posters that I dig on. I really love his style, and Julie Bell is obviously hugely indebted to his style, but I really like her stuff too. I thought she was better at doing the superhero type stuff. She had that more classical superhero anatomy, and she was good at doing the shiny metals more so even than Boris. I love them both. I really enjoy their artwork, but it seems like their profile diminished greatly in the 2000s, which is a shame, but I definitely enjoy their work, and I'm always happy to look through their art books. I dig them.
Are you sending more?
Daniel Torres.
No familiarity.
He was definitely one of those guys who would be doing like the thieves running across a Moroccan rooftop kind of stories that I wasn't really down for. It just wasn't really much of my taste, but I appreciated it being in there because he had his own distinctive style. There was a lot different than anybody else in Heavy Metal magazine, so I appreciated that at least. Milo Manara.
No, I remember seeing this. Looks dope. Looks awesome.
Surely Fix-It knows him at least, right? Manara, Milo Manara.
Oh, yeah. I own some of his books. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. A few years ago, re-recorded a segment that I don't know. A, I misplaced it, and B, I ended up not using, where the internet had decided to take him to task for how he drew Spider-Woman on a cover, and you had these fucking morons who are trying to explain to Manara how to draw the female form when he's a fucking master of it. And I had a frothing at the mouth, angry retort to that. And then I remember that he also did a lot of rapey stuff, a lot of, you know, a lot of stories where consent was very muddy at best. And I'm like, you know what? Maybe I don't want to put my neck out quite so far, but I think that he is one of the truly great artists in the history of comic books. I love his stuff. It's beautiful. It's deeply erotic. Very few people can draw a woman as well as he does. Just gorgeous, gorgeous work. And of the various artists associated with Heavy Metal magazine, he's one of the most ones I've collected the most extensively. I will buy, like, the Dark Horse did a series of collections of his work. And he's, of course, worked with some famous filmmakers and done numerous graphic novels that aren't necessarily erotic, although that's his primary interest. And it still irritates the hell out of me. This is an instance where, as liberal as a guy as I am, I really do hate the fucking PC police driving him away from doing those Marvel covers that he was doing, because I think it's just exceptional work. And if you don't like how he draws a lady in his butt up in the air, well, you know, don't buy that fucking variant cover. Shut the fuck up. Who fucking asked you?
Yeah.
Funny note on that. It sold for $37,500, that original cover.
I totally year. Fucking dig that cover, and it made me want to read that series, but then they turned around and gave her some shitty costume with like a jacket and like, you know, made her look all practical like she was from fucking Project Rooftop or some shit, and just completely killed the buzz. And then most recently they did a new Spider-Woman series where they gave her this all mostly black outfit that looked like fucking shit. And Dave Johnson designed it. Usually I like Johnson's stuff, but it's like there's nothing wrong with the costume, guys. You need to figure out how to make people give a shit about the character. The costume, I think, looks great, and especially when you got a great artist, you know, drawing it. She doesn't have to be a sex pot, but it don't hurt either.
Cover's rad. He's dope.
Rowena?
No.
No.
I wanted to get a little female representation in there, and I thought she'd probably be good after I knew that I was going to be talking up Manara. But she was one of the generic fantasy artists. She did a lot of heavy metal covers, but it wasn't one of the ones that ever really resonated that much with me. Peter Cooper?
No.
Nope.
He's a guy I associate more with, like, you know, the New Yorker kind of like high-end type of work. Well, obviously much more abstract. I like his stuff fairly well, but it was definitely the artsier side of heavy metal when he would appear in it. And I think he appeared more in the latter days, you know, like the 2000s or so. Paul Kirchner.
This looks familiar.
Yeah, I was going to say, same for me. It looks familiar, but I couldn't place it.
I like his stuff. Not one of the more famous artists, though. I've got some of his books. Haven't read too many of them. I think he's like a libertarian or something, too. But I really like that clean, clear art style of his.
I think he's like a libertarian.
Holy so that Christ. Somehow affects his artwork, or?
Well, you know, it helps if I like a person's politics as well. But here's Guido Kripax.
I've seen that, but I...
He did an adaptation of Emmanuel, and given that I have a strong interest in that film series and the book, I should have a copy of that. But his style just never really worked that great for me. It's really European, but it's like... he does a lot of erotica that I don't find to be particularly erotic, and just not enough detailing for my taste, so... So we have associate very strongly with heavy metal and that type of book, but I've never been a huge fan of his work specifically. Pepe Moreno.
No.
Nada.
I think he's got a nice style, but I think for the most part he's just known for the one strip Rebel, which was always being advertised in graphic novel form in the heavy metals when I was reading it in the 80s and 90s, but not a huge amount of familiarity with his work.
Yeah, I mean, I think it definitely looks cool, but I'm not familiar with any of it.
Yeah.
Serpiri.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I owned a bunch of this shit. All the art books and stuff. It's fucking weird.
Yeah, I remember you being a big fan of his cross-hatching, and I think that he was probably a pretty big influence on Frank Cho.
I think it looks cool. Not sure I've seen it before, but I like it.
I know I've sold Fix-It some Druna volumes for sure. I remember that well.
Yeah.
I wish you would have sold me some.
Liberatore.
Yeah. Is that Android guy, right?
Ranzerox. At least they used to be called that before the Xerox Corporation got upset with them, and so I think they just call it like Ran or X or some shit now.
Are you serious? Oh, man. Thanks a lot, Xerox.
It was one of those painted art styles that was so far in advance of anything I'd seen as a reader that it was like I couldn't comprehend how you'd gotten those kind of flesh tones and stuff in painting. So I really was super interested in it. And then a few years ago, Dark Horse was going to finally collect the entire series of stories that had run in heavy metal. And of course, I'd always seen it advertised in graphic novel form. And then again, I think it was the Internet Archive. I went to go check it out and flip through it and realized serious fucking pedo-afibo stuff going on in there. And it's like, I don't want to have this in my house. I'm going to get arrested. I don't want this shit getting mailed to me. So as much as I love the art style, I've never properly read it and I can't own it. So I probably never will, because you can go to some places that you could get away with in the Taxi Driver, Jodie Foster days of the 1970s that you really don't want to be around in the 2000s, you know?
Yeah, these couple panels you sent over look really cool.
Olivia de Berardi. Venus, although thankfully she mostly goes by Olivia.
Yeah, I own a bunch of her, I think a card set of her stuff.
I think I remember the card set. Yeah, I think I, I know Olivia. She's pretty famous, right?
Yeah, she did a lot of the heavy metal, either the magazines or the specials around the time that I was most interested in the magazine, the late 80s, early 90s. And so with the between her and Luis Arroyo are the two artists that I most associate with heavy metal. And of course, you know, hardly anybody draws women as beautiful as either one of these artists, but Olivia became quite famous for it. And of course, she's a huge influence on other artists I love, like Joe Linzner. So yeah, there's always a place in my collection for an Olivia book, or I mean, I'm always happy to see her do a cover or something like that. Just extraordinary artist and a highly influential one as well.
She did lots of like Betty Page stuff, right?
Yeah. Along with Dave Stevens, she's one of the artists that really helped to popularize Betty Page after she had been forgotten for a few decades there.
Word, word.
Juan Jimenez.
No.
Definitely looks giggerish to me.
Yeah, if of the sci-fi stuff that heavy metal did, this was probably one of the prototypical styles, and obviously extremely detailed and very attractive. My problem is that he mostly worked with Jodorowsky, whose work I've generally avoided. It never really resonated with me. I know Siskoid's a fan, but I never really followed it that much. And also, so much of this was released through Humanoids rather than through heavy metal. And I just, you know, they do either graphic novels or they do comic book sized publications, and it just never was something that I gravitated toward. I just don't have a lot of this stuff around, and so I don't have a lot of exposure to it. The artistry I think is amazing, and I think you can definitely see where this person would have had influence on guys like Travis Charest, who I'm a fan of, and who also worked with Jodorowsky, but I just don't have a lot of experience with it, but definitely very much in the heavy metal vein, I think.
Bisley? I remember a lot of Bisley stuff.
That was more the 90s, but yeah.
So
at the very end, you're correct. He opens the trap door. He falls through the trap door. The Lagnar starts talking about, you know, kind of going into the next story, and you see Hanover's hand with the marble in it as it's burning. And then we're introduced to a B-52?
B-17. Okay, so I said Neverwhereland because I'm looking at the Wikipedia. Neverwhereland says because of time constraints, a segment called Neverwhereland, which would have been Captain Stern to B-17, was cut. Story follows the influence of the Lochnar upon the evolution of a planet from Lochnar landing in a bottle of water, influencing the rise of the industrial age. No, never.
Okay, if you have the VHS, it is on the extra. Is it the VHS or the DVD? One of them does have it as an extra feature, and it's all done in like ballpoint pen art style.
Oh yeah, I see the ballpoint pen stuff on YouTube. They've got it. That's pretty cool. Yeah, it is a very ballpoint pen on like construction paper, almost like the animated storyboards kind of in a way. It's on YouTube, so you can watch it.
Very cool looking. Yeah, I remember hearing about it, never saw it, but you're correct. For time restraints, they took it out, and I did watch the special features. I mean, it's amazing because it is through ballpoint, and it's just a cool style, but it doesn't really take anything out of the story, I don't think.
Yeah, I guess it was supposed to bridge the gap between the two. Okay, so the next we got B-17.
How about we let Frank discuss this one?
This one's pretty straightforward. So the animatics you talked about were by Cornelius Cole III, and that was very much like one of those silent stories I was talking about earlier from the magazine. So it's a shame it wasn't in there, but the B-17 isn't that far off. There's a little bit of dialogue, but mostly it's set apparently in World War II. You got a fighter plane that's almost his entire crew has been wiped out. There's only, I think, the pilot and one man still left. And so the guy's going through and inspecting, you know, the damage is done and if anybody has survived. And unfortunately, the Lochnar then arrives to reanimate the corpses, which then do what corpses tend to do and attack the
there's zombies.
Yeah, they're zombies, yeah. And ultimately, the plane crashes. The pilot, I think, survives. It was the pilot that survives. Well, and no, he finds himself... Okay. I'm assuming this is sort of like a Bermuda Triangle kind of situation. So he gets out, he parachutes out of the plane. He lands on an island, and he finds himself in an airplane graveyard, which is all together manned by more of these zombies that creep up on him to kill him. And there is one song in that segment. It's a fairly brief segment called Heavy Metal, Taking a Ride. That's Don Felder. Also a pretty damn cool cool tune. Both of the tunes with the title Heavy Metal are pretty damn cool. But I would say this is the lesser of the two.
Now, is this also, this is Rotoscope, right? At least the plain portions are.
I honestly would say that most, if not all, the movie is Rotoscope. It's just that you've got, like, the opening sequence during the credit sequence, I think that might actually be literal photography that's been altered and animated. Whereas this is, clearly they've animated over live action actors to give it that fluidity. I think pretty much all the movie is rotoscoped, or at least large portions of it, I would assume, because it was a common practice in the day. And this was not like a well-known animation house. I do think they were probably Canadian. So almost certainly they were using rotoscope, which some people would argue is a cheat, but I don't think you get that nearly as much these days, especially with, you know, CGI. There's a way bigger cheat when the animation is done through math as opposed to actually having to do it by hand. So I think there's a lot bigger allowance for rotoscoping now, and it's less of a, for a long time they were in 2D animation, it was like a dirty secret. Like, nobody wanted to cop to it because it's like they were cheating. Whereas I love rotoscoped animation, especially when it's done right. Bakshi is one of the best at that. Whereas this one feels more like traditional animation. And if you told me it was traditional, I would have believed you, but I'm also perfectly willing to think that it was rotoscoped as well.
It's totally rotoscoped, dude. You're great. Yeah. I mean, no, it's this whole movie's rotoscoped. It to some extent. No.
So Beautiful's Dangerous is not. Tarna is not.
Tarna has got to be rotoscoped. Are you kidding me? Tarna's rotoscoped, man.
She's rotoscoped, dude.
You think so?
Yes. They're just drawing over an actress running. That's what it is. Now, like, obviously the backgrounds aren't rotoscoped, right? They didn't actually, like, film a fantasy land and then color over it with fucking pencils. But it's rotoscoped.
All matte paintings anyway, weren't they?
Who now what?
Weren't most of the backgrounds matte paintings anyway?
Yeah. Because especially confirmed by the site that I see selling the animated sales, like, most of it is just like a figure, right, with no background. It's because they laid it over the
A lot of that stuff is like that. Yeah,
but the figures are all rotoscoped. The people in all of these cartoon segments are rotoscoped because they kind of move in that semi-slow motion. You know what I'm saying? Like, that all rotoscope kind of looks like it's slow motion in a way. No, doesn't it? No.
I don't know. If you watch Fire and Ice, it definitely has a fluidity to it.
I think Fire and Ice next to Walt Disney is probably the best rotoscoping ever used in animation.
The what now?
Well, if I recall correctly, Walt Disney used rotoscope for stuff like Snow White.
Well, yeah, like Snow White dancing. Yeah. They're dancing.
Yeah, but I would say Fire and Ice probably did it better than probably anybody this side of Disney, and maybe even better than Disney did it. Fire and Ice, the fluidity of the animation is so beautiful and graceful. Whereas with something like this, I think what Mac's catching on to is they're probably doing stuff like loops, where it's just like a small sequence of live action that's being animated, or they're just taking shortcuts and not using as many frames per second. And so you don't have that same level of fluidity, but you do have a movement that you wouldn't have conjured up purely from your imagination. That's a movement that looks human enough to where you figure they're probably just painting over photos of humans or cells of humans.
I thought B-17 didn't have like the best animation in the movie, but I thought the subject matter was more interesting. I liked what they did with the airplane. I feel like inside the airplane, there was way more hatching and detail in it because it was a smaller space. So I approved the animation in B-17.
And it's the simplest of all the stories.
Well, I know. But again, they put a ton of detail into the airplane because that's all they had to do, right? Yeah. It was just inside an airplane. So I appreciated the detail.
Heavy Metal Magazine, I think when it was first created, it was actually National Lampoon. Do you guys even, like, I know Fix It was the movie. Do you guys remember the magazines?
I remember those magazines.
Not I.
So, National Lampoon was, not only was it a comedy magazine, I mean, you're familiar with the basic history of the National Lampoon. It's a spinoff of the Harvard Lampoon. It was basically this editorial group at Harvard University that specialized in comedy and typically, I don't want to say lowbrow, but definitely a more boundary-pushing humor. And eventually, after these guys graduated, after they'd been doing like a newsletter on the campus, they actually had a proper syndicated magazine that would have editorials and political commentary and, anything that would be of interest to like a young man and a person who was interested in the worldly things, but but seeing it from a humorous slant. And because of the popularity of the magazine, they eventually spun off into making movies, and that's where you get things like Animal House. Lampoon's Vacation. You know, there's this close association between the type of humor you would see in National Lampoon and like Saturday Night Live, which is sort of a hybrid of Monty Python and National Lampoon. And that's why a lot of those guys end up being in those movies and such. So again, kind of a snapshot of its time of baby boomers coming of age, being more libertine than the older generations, and maybe mixing, you know, suggestive humor with politics and movie reviews and all that kind of good stuff. And one of the most famous covers was the one where you've got a magnum
pointing the gun at
the dog. Yeah, buy this magazine or you shoot the dog, something like that.
Yeah, I remember seeing about that.
And what I think about too is we just recently were talking about how the Kentucky Fried Movie was recently streaming on what was it, Peacock?
Amazon Prime's got it.
Was it Amazon?
No, Prime? Amazon.
Okay, and I watched it up to the Fistful of Yen, and I'll probably go back to it later on. And you know, I watched with the girlfriend just to see how she'd react. She left almost immediately, and a lot of it was, you know, making fun of like Mandingo movies and lots of gay panic jokes and lots of TNA. Just that kind of humor was definitely a reflection of what you were seeing in things like National Lampoon, where it's very much, especially young boomer men who either had maybe they didn't become hippies, but they were definitely more libertine, and they enjoyed this esoteric mix in their humor, and they liked it to be a little saucy.
When did Kentucky Fried Movie come out? Probably around the same time, right? Late 70s, early 80s, something like that.
I don't know. I only saw the movie because Frank recommended it to me. I remember you brought it up one time to me, and I was like, I've never seen that movie, and you told me to watch it, and I think I caught it on cable one time, and I'm just like, wow, this is
77 was Kentucky Fried Movie.
Yeah, I saw that in the late 80s on the Movie Channel. They used to run a lot of I don't think it was Joe Bob Briggs because he tended to focus more on horror stuff, but I think it was one of those hosted I don't know if it was a hosted program or not, but they tended, particularly the Movie Channel, would do like weird stuff and provocative stuff, especially in late night. And so that was my exposure to Kentucky Fried Movie, I think. Either that or it was an early video store rental, one of the two.
Mine was a combination of two. I think I saw it on TV and was like, oh, that's funny. Except, of course, it's like heavily edited. So then I rented it from the video store. And of course, it's like not rated or whatever, but I rented it anyway. I had a few not rated rentals that made impressions on me as a kid. But and I was like, whoa, there's like nudity in this movie. And it was like, you know, extremely raunchy and sophomore humor and stuff. And
wasn't there another one similar to that called like Amazon Women from the Moon or something?
Yeah.
That was about a decade later, but it wasn't nearly as good. And it wasn't nearly as insane either.
The other not rated movie I bought thinking it was something else was The Toxic Avenger, the live action one. But I was
I rented that. I remember renting that and enjoying it quite a bit.
Yeah, me too.
Was that like Nuclear High or something
there in the movie?
Say that again?
They had another movie like Nuclear High or something like that.
Well, I remember what do you call it? Because The Toxic Avenger, you know, gets all mutated. Mm-hmm. Or was it The Toxic Crusader? There was the cartoon The Crusader and the movie was Toxic Avenger?
The movie was The Toxic Avenger and the cartoon, short-lived, was The Toxic Crusaders, if I remember correctly.
So I liked the cartoon, so I thought the movie was going to be like the cartoon, and instead, you know, it's like it's got nudity and stuff in it. But
yeah,
because there's like the scene where because he meets up with that blind chick, and the blind chick doesn't like judge him because she's blind. You know what I'm saying? And then at some point
Alicia Masters action
was that? Is that who that was? They have relations and there's nudity in it, and I was like, whoa, this is way better than The Toxic Crusader.
I want to say that was the one that I caught on the Movie Channel too. I think that was one of those late night weirdo movies that they would run. I think they ran the first couple of them. I never saw Class of Newcomb High. I'm familiar with it vaguely.
I catch bits
of Surf Nazis Must Die. All that trauma shit was very much in the same vein as heavy metal, but of course they didn't have the unlimited budget that the comic book provided, but very much in that same vein of violent and transgressive storytelling.
And if I remember correctly, we rented the movies, and it was one of those things where we went to a place and it was like, you know, so-and-so recommends this movie, and that's why I saw a lot of these movies. They would have like the little recommendations, and that's where The Toxic Avenger and all those movies I was exposed to. So.
Well, yeah, if you went to the proper library, you and I might have even gone to the same library, fix it, but they'd have those movie guys, like Joe Bob Briggs had a movie guide that it was rated on a scale of like number of boobs and number of deaths, or you'd have like the psychotropic guy. There's all those weird gonzo type of movies that again hit perfectly for feral Gen Xers and boomers and such.
Another movie that falls in this category that I accidentally rented was the 1987 thriller Black Widow, because the cover was just black with, and it just said Black Widow on it. I don't know if this was a Blockbuster or where I, or maybe Hollywood or something. I can't remember. And I started watching it. And I'm like, oh, this has nothing to do with like the comic character or anything like that. Like this movie.
Wasn't that like Deborah Winger or some shit? Because I had the exact same reaction. Yes. I kept wanting it to be related to the comic book in some way. And of course, it never was. That's how fucking desperate we were back in the 70s and 80s, where it's like, just because you used a title that's associated with a comic book thing, you're like, is this a comic book thing? Is this a comic thing? It's like, no, it's a fucking like noir thriller and shit. But I never saw it, but I remember looking at that box to make sure there was no Marvel connection back in the day. Like 87, I think that was.
Yeah. 87, Deborah Winger and Teresa Russell.
Russell, I definitely know that there were boobies in that then, right?
I want to say there was, but I think that one might have been like the Toxic Avenger could keep my attention as a kid, whereas this one was like, what, it was some fucking thriller or some shit. I was probably like, next, turn it off. We're watching Ninja Turtles. I'm watching Ninja Turtles.
I remember going to the video store and being introduced to Tino Brass films. And that was have y'all ever seen Tino Brass films?
Oh yeah, I've seen some of the ones you've lent me, in fact. I think you gave me a copy or two of those.
Yeah, those things. I just remember, we were talking about the video store, dude, was a magical place where discovery was around every corner.
I know I've talked a lot about how we almost never had cable, but we had to have had it enough, because that type of stuff I would have seen a lot on cable. And especially once we had VCRs, I'd have been taping some of that stuff. I still have copies on VHS of like Girls Without Lovers and shit like that. You know, those soft core European imports. And see, again, that's part of the fun of heavy metal, is not only did you have like the sci-fi boobies in the stories, but they always had advertisements for other stuff that you had to mail order. And some of that stuff was almost invariably either a softcore porn or actually full-on porn, especially once it got into the 90s. And so you could kind of get off on seeing the little tiny, you know, literally like postage stamp size images of erotica that was very much in that vein of Tinto Brass.
Well, it's just so weird going thinking about this, because I still remember, do you remember the first pornographic comic book you bought?
The funny part is, as far as like truly pornographic comic book, I didn't buy it. My mother bought it and I stole hers.
That's the most Frank shit I've ever heard in my life.
Oh, dude, that's ultimate Frank right there.
Yeah, because like occasionally there would be those magazines that were just collections of like the one-page gag strips that you'd have in adult magazines. You know, it was a full-page illustration in color, and then they have like a little written gag at the bottom of it. And so my mother would pick those up from the gas station on occasion, but specifically, one of the only times I got to the real Third Planet, the one downtown, or not downtown, it's like Midtown, right? We got there once, and they had copies of Cherry Pop-Tart, and I don't know what possessed her to pick that up, but she picked that up and a few others, and I think my stepfather at some point bought some as well. So they would get it, they'd read their toss-through the one time, they'd be done with it, and I'd sneak in there and steal that shit. And I still don't think I have one or two of those left over after all these years.
I still remember going to a comic shop, and someone, I guess, had grabbed it and then tossed it on top of the book, and it was a copy of Two Girls, Hot Night, Two Hot Girls, or something. Like, it was something weird like that, and the guy, I remember I put it in my stack of comics. I'm just like, maybe he won't even notice. Like, I could just kind of get away with it. And I always remember he looked at me, he looked at it, and he's like, uh-huh, and he just kept going, like, no big deal, dude. Didn't even phase him.
I did that one time at the flea market shop. Is they had gotten a few adult books in. This would have probably been like early 90s, okay? And I had a good rapport with the girl who worked there. She kind of looked like Tracy Bonham, the singer. And so I'm like, okay, I'm gonna try this. I'm gonna try to sneak this through.
Maybe it was Tracy Bonham.
Maybe, she hadn't broken out yet. And so there's an issue of Rumba, which was, I think, an Italian magazine about like an assassin who typically got around to fucking people before she killed them. And so that's how I snuck out that one issue of Rumba, was just like kind of worked in with the other, you know, action-oriented books. And either she didn't know better, or I kind of think she did, and she just like let me slide, because, you know, teenage boy, give me a break.
I want to say mine, I think, was like a Clive Barker's Nightbreed issue or some shit.
That was your porn? That explains so much about you right now.
No, definitely not. No, definitely. Dude, I had a buddy of mine who had his mom let him have a Playboy subscription. So I wasn't looking for comics with nudity in it, bro. That's the whole moral of the story. But I think the first like issue, like an actual comic book that I saw with boobs in it, was like Clive Barker's Nightbreed.
Oh, dude, we've all come across those fucking boxes in parking lots full of fucking torn up, you know, worn out porn. That's nothing new, but I'm like actually buying a comic book, pornographic comic book from a shop. Because I mean, I was underage at the time. I was underage, and I remember thinking like, I was just like, fuck it, I'm just gonna go for it. Like, not, you know, what is it saying? Fortune favors the bold.
Yeah, it's a rite of passage to nut up and actually walk up to a counter with something you know you're not supposed to have, you know you're not age appropriate for, and try to get away with that shit. It's like the first time you try to buy beer when you're underage, you know.
And the crazy thing was, I was 25 cents short, and the guy was like, you know, you're 25 cents short, and I'm like, fuck. So I had to go out and ask my family member who's waiting in the car that gave me a ride to the shop if they could loan me a fucking quarter. I remember that.
I've got a nut riding on this, Mom.
Mom, you don't understand. No, you'll be able to keep your Sears catalog if I can have 25 cents. Holy shit.
But we're getting back to a classic time that I don't think is replicated anymore. You'll remember, like, and boys and girls both did this, is somebody would go dumpster diving and find, like, strip cover magazines and stuff, or discarded porn, and the whole group would get together out in the woods somewhere or on the back behind the apartment complex and shit, and look through the girly magazine. Boys and girls, because we were all curious about this shit. And again, it was mana from heaven. We didn't have, especially if you didn't have cable, and especially poor kids didn't happen to have a lot of cable. So you'd have this crusty, water damaged, you know, sometimes it was individual pages. It wasn't even an entire magazine. And everybody would be flipping through it just because we didn't know this shit. And it was like natural exploration. It was the only avenue to find stuff like that.
Yep.
He said water damaged, folks. He said water damaged. Or you'd find, like, where I was up in Northern Arizona, it was extremely wooded, right? So you'd just be cutting through the woods because you wanted to get from one place to another without walking down the street, and you'd run across, like, a homeless, like, you know, where they'd slept there that night, and you just, there'd usually be like a couple fucking magazines there or whatever. All sorts of random places you'd find this shit. We did not steal porn from homeless people, but whatever.
They would just leave it. They were nomads. But Hobo got a nut too.
We were picking up a litter, helping the environment. I remember another time I was walking home from school, and there was like some torn up magazine, like, on the ground. I picked it up, and it was straight up porn. Like, somebody had got busted with some, and their mom had either cut it up or they were trying to dispose of it and then threw it out the window. And there was literally, like, every 5 feet I walked, there was another, like, part of a page. And I was like, oh, I guess I'm collecting these today. More cleaning up the environment.
Best jigsaw puzzle ever.
Yeah. Like, the story makes no sense, but I'm into it.
I always remember when I had a friend that her mom had a waterbed. Do you remember the old waterbed, Frank?
Oh, boy, do we all have nightmarish stories of the waterbeds. Yes.
So the waterbed had, like, these drawers on the bottom. And so we're hanging out in her mom's room because her mom had cable in the room. And so we're all sitting there, and somebody reached under the little cabinet under, or the little drawers underneath, and they pulled it open, and there's, you know, pornographic tapes, there's some magazines. That was the first time I ever saw a sex toy and did not know what it was. And I remember my friend, like, picking it up and looking at it, and she's like, we're all just kind of looking at it. Now that I'm older, I'm like, oh god, I hope it wasn't used. But at the time, we didn't know. And I kind of remember that now. Y'all kind of took me back to that moment.
I had a buddy of mine who was trying to find money in his parents' room. And when he pulled the drawer out, a marital assistant tool rolled out and hit his hand, and he never went back into the room ever again. He was like traumatized.
Also, he knew what it was, because I didn't know what this was. I just never seen it. I remember it was your basic, and it was like a light pink. And I remember looking, I'm like, I kind of knew what it was, but you were like, is that really what it is? Like, you know, I'd never seen one in person.
Oh no, this was a full dildo, so he definitely knew what it was, and it rolled out and touched his hand, and he absolutely, he like barely get the words out. I was like, dude, what happened? Like, he was like traumatized for. I was like, he's like, dude, this is what happened to me yesterday. I was like, oh my god, it's horrific. This dude's traumatized for life. Very hilarious. Then of course we made fun of him forever because of.
Oh, of course you have to.
Most of us never go back to that place once we come out, you know. So.
Yeah, he was just like, oh, I mean, my dad is older, I guess. It was horrible.
All I know is my mother never worked hard enough to have that many back massagers.
Oh, Frank.
To grow up in the 80s and 90s. Next is So Beautiful and So Dangerous.
Yeah.
And
this one is based on the comic book of the same name by Angus McKee. It's actually not a short story from Heavy Metal. This is a full-on graphic novel, like 64 pages or something. And it's so weird because, like, virtually none of the story actually made it in the cartoon. This one is almost entirely created for the cartoon. And really, the cartoon doesn't tell a story. It's basically just a bunch of vignettes using character designs by Angus McKee, but almost nothing to do with the original comic book. So it's a weird that they even bothered to give him a credit on this. They could have just changed the look of the aliens, and they'd have probably been just fine.
Well, they like the title, too. I mean, the name is pretty cool.
Well, and they use the little robot, and they use the smiley face spaceship. They use some elements, but not a lot.
And I think for a while, if you look in the old comic, the magazines of heavy metal, I think they were selling animated cells of that at the time. Like, I want to say I found some, like, 1980 ones where they're, like, selling them on, like, through mail order. Because I remember distinctly seeing one of the smiley face spaceship, which I always thought looked fucking amazing. We all now know where fucking Deadmau5 got his look from.
Yeah, it reminds me of a cartoon that they ran on Night Flight, if I remember correctly, about, like, roaches using robots to try to conquer the world. And there's, like, a ridiculous, like, Captain Everything sort of superhero and this little kid character and such. And a lot of those design elements seem to have derived from this particular short.
Okay. I just always remember one time I saw a fucking cover of Deadmau5 and I was like, shit, that's so beautiful, so dangerous. Like, what the fuck? With the whole mouth and the eyes and stuff.
Yeah, and Angus McKee has an extremely unique style and very ornate. It's another instance where it looks like it was done on a computer before the computers could do anything like this.
Yeah.
And it's very much so 70s and 80s. So many, like, weird pastel-y colors, and everything's got that sheen to it, that metallic lighting and shit. And it's just super unique art style. And it's weird to me that a guy that could paint that well didn't get to be more famous. But I guess he wasn't the most prolific guy. He did some more stuff in heavy metal. He did some stuff for DC and the 90s. He also did get into computer animation, which I don't think did him any favors. Very few people who were doing computer stuff in the 90s were doing work that holds up very well today. But this project looks really good, but it's almost zero reflection in the cartoon. The cartoon's just kind of doing its own thing. It's basically an extended music video with lots of drug references.
And you have Don, and you have John Candy again, and you have what's his name? Egon, the actor. Ghostbusters. Oh.
Harold Ramis.
Yeah, my brain wasn't clicking in, and we both hit it at the same time.
I kept wanting to say Eugene Levy, and I was like, it's not Eugene Levy.
And I don't know about you guys. I've always had trouble with those two. They're not really that similar, but for some reason, I still kind of confuse them.
Well, I mean, I'm looking at the Wikipedia, and this is Eugene Levy is the male reporter. So he's in it.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
But I mean, all those guys. And Joe Flaherty's in there, too. All those guys are in there. For some reason, the girls from SCTV didn't appear to be in the cartoon, but all the guys were.
Yeah, they all lend their voices.
I don't think they got Moranis, though, did they?
No. John Candy did quite a lot of heavy lifting in this movie, because he did quite a few voices.
It says Harold Ramis is Zeke in So Beautiful and So Damaged.
Yep.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Wait, who did we just say? Harold Ramis.
Harold Ramis,
you asked if they had who?
Eugene Levy.
No, not Eugene Levy. Frank, who'd you just say?
Rick Moranis.
Rick Moranis. Okay, no. Okay, gotcha. Getting all these 80s Canadian actors mixed up.
What did y'all think of this? Well, we know what Frank thought of Saw. What about you, Matt?
Of which one? We didn't even explain this one, but basically, chick gets beamed up into space. She has sex with robots, and they do blow. Right, that's basically what it is.
Yeah, pretty much.
I thought that this was like legit excellent animation in this one. The robots, the creature creation, the fluidity of the movement, the detail in the backgrounds. I thought this was not the best of the movie, but probably second place.
Yeah, I would tend to agree. It probably does have the best animation because they're not even attempting to tell a story, and it's very much like Hookers and Blow. This is exactly what you're here for. You literally have like a vacuum machine that spits up coke rather than sucking it down, because that's all for the aliens' noses. You also, it's just one song after another too. You've got Queen Bee by Grand Funk Railroad. You got I Must Be Dreaming by Cheap Trick, which was one of my favorites on the soundtrack.
Yeah.
You got Crazy, A Suitable Case for Treatment by Nazareth. You've got All of You by Don Felder. You got Prefabricated by Trust. And then the coup de grace, Heavy Metal by Sammy Hagar. Probably the best song on the album.
Metal.
Oh yeah, it's absolutely the soundtrack for the album and the magazine. The lyrics are so perfect for all this material.
Let's be honest,
you know?
This episode was definitely a time capsule into that time where cocaine was seen as like recreational. Everybody does coke. Like, it's not a big deal. Nope.
How the fuck you think this shit got animated, motherfucker?
I love the line in this one where they're talking about how she bangs that robot and stuff, and she's like, mixed marriages don't work. I'm afraid I'll come home and find you screwing a toaster or something like that. This one definitely had the most laughs.
Trust me.
Yeah, This one had the most like legit laughs.
Well, she was going to make the robot compute to Judaism too, wasn't she? Wasn't she going to make the robot convert to Judaism?
Yes.
Yeah, something like that.
She wants a Jewish wedding.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I didn't think, and actually at this point, I wouldn't have, I saw this movie after Van Hagar. So the only thing I knew Sammy Hagar from was I Can't Drive 55 when he took over for Diamond Dave. I would have given more credence to his time in Van Halen if I'd known he had done this song and if it had been exposed to the song beforehand. But by the time I saw this movie, I think we were already into the Crystal Pepsi era of Van Halen. So even heavy metal couldn't quite salvage it, but definitely one of, if not the best, Hagar songs.
Yes, and androids are people too. That's actually graffiti written on the side of the ship.
I drive way better when I'm stoned.
Good landing, man.
I just love the fact that when the robot and the woman are going through the ship, it's massive inside. It's like a small planet. And then they get to the space station, and it's just massive.
Before